Mais dou, mais serve your God today. How great thou art, we love you, Jesus. How great thou art. Worship this God that is great. Go ahead and give him a praise this morning in your own words, in your own tongue. Go ahead and worship the Lord. Magnify his holy name. Worship him in the beauty of his holiness. He's a good, good God. He's a faithful God. If the Lord has been good to you, go ahead and bless his name this morning. Magnify the Lord. The psalmist says, I will bless the Lord at all times. His praise shall continually be in my mouth. He says, magnify the Lord with me. Let us exalt his name together. Brethren, this morning, the Lord is here. His presence is here. Go ahead and give him a praise. Give him a worship that is worthy of him. Go ahead and magnify the Lord. Bless his name. He's a good, good Father. He's a great, great God. There is none that compares with him. It is written, in him we live and move and have our being. He's the source of your life. He's the reason why you are alive today. He's the reason why we are here today. Bless his name. Give him a praise. Give him worship. Father, we bless your name. Thank you, Father. What a mighty God we serve. Hallelujah. What a mighty God. If the Lord is mighty in your eyes, go ahead and worship him. Oh, heaven and earth adore, even angels bow before. Oh, what a mighty God. I want you to personalize it this morning. Oh, hallelujah. A mighty God, I shall personalize it. Hallelujah. What a mighty God, I shall. Hallelujah. Heaven and earth adore, even angels bow before. Oh, what a mighty God. Believe the Lord that you serve, the Lord I serve is mighty. Give him the worship that is due unto him this morning. It is written, when the praises go up, the glory of God will come. Let your praise go up unto him this morning. If the Lord indeed is mighty, if the Lord is bigger than all your cares and all your worries, all your problems, magnify his name this morning. Worship him in the beauty of his holiness. Give him a praise, brethren. Shout hallelujah unto his name. He is Lord. He is Lord. There is none that compares with him. Thank you, blessed Redeemer. We give you praise and we give you worship. You are good and you are kind, and your mercies endure forever. The psalmist wrote and says, oh, that men would praise the Lord for his goodness and for his wonderful works, even unto the children of men. Thank you, Father. We are grateful. We are grateful, Lord. Lord, we are grateful. We do not take your goodness unto us for granted. We do not take your mercies, oh God, for granted. It is written, it's of your mercies, Lord, that we are not consumed, because your compassion, they faileth not. It is written, the steadfast love of the Lord, it never ceases. Father, we thank you, oh, for daily loading us with your benefits. Thank you, Father. Father, we have tasted of your goodness, Lord, and we bless your name this morning. Come and take your place in our gathering, Lord, this morning. Lord, the praises have gone up to you, O God. Let your glory fall. Let it come down now, Lord, upon us, upon your people, and pour upon us, Lord, a blessing that there shall not be room enough to receive it, O God. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father. The entrance of your word, it gives light. It gives understanding to the simple. And as we hear your words this morning, Father, let your word bring refreshment unto our spirit man. And Lord, we pray, O God, for grace to be doers of your word and not hearers only, in the mighty name of Jesus. Let your word transform us this morning. Let it quicken us in the name of Jesus. From every slumberness that, Lord, we might have been in, Father, bring us back to light. Bring us back to our awakeness in the name of Jesus Christ. Thank you, Almighty God. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. Let's give the Lord a clap offering this morning. Give him a praise. Give him a praise. Worship him. He's a good, good Father. He's a good, good God. And before you take your seats, with the permission of our Father and the Lord, please welcome somebody beside you. Say you are welcome in Jesus' name. The Lord will bless you this morning because you have come. The Lord will visit you. My blessings will be more than yours, though, but the Lord will still bless you. Hallelujah. Oh, thank you, Jesus. Ah, thank you, sir. He's a good, good God. He's a good, good Father. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. You may take your seats. Amen. Brother Stanley, are we ready? Hallelujah. Praise the name of the Lord. This morning, I want us to start by listening to a song, a beautiful song. Please don't start it yet. Just pause it until I tell you to start. Amen. Amen. A great man that I've spoken about before, a great man that had a ministry. Oh, is that Brother George? Hallelujah. Welcome, sir. Amen. That his ministry was... first, amen. His ministry was so short, but in the short time this man ministered, the impact he made is still resounding even today. He died mysteriously in 82, but his ministry is still resounding today. What an impactful ministry. The song we're about to listen to is Asleep in the Light. The Bible says we are the salt of the earth. We are the light of the world. Asleep in the light. Please listen. I think the lyrics will be shown. Please make sure you stage, put it well so that it's well seen, so that we can perhaps read the lyrics. Amen. Amen. Let's go on. God bless you. Play.
See all the people sinking down. Don't you care? Don't you care? Are you gonna let them drown? How can you be so numb not to care if they come? You close your eyes and pretend the job's done. Bless me, Lord. Bless me, Lord. You know, it's all I ever hear. No one aches, no one hurts, no one even sheds one tear. But he cries, he weeps, he bleeds, and he cares for your needs. And you just lay back and keep soaking it in. Streets. Open up, and give yourself away. You see the need, you hear the cries, so how can you delay? God's calling, and you're the one, but like Johnny Lund, he's told you to speak. just done.
Father, we thank you this morning. Speak unto our hearts, O God. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Before I go into the message, with the permission of our pastor, I will share this video clip in the BTS something so that we can follow the lyrics. I see it was small. But a stanza, it says, first of all, the title, as you saw, is Asleep in the Light. When there is light, it's not the time to sleep. Jesus Christ said in John 9, verse 4, I must walk the works of him who sent me while it's day, for the night cometh when no man can walk. The daytime is the time to walk and to walk for God and, of course, to walk for yourself. Asleep in the Light is a message addressed to the church, to BTS, to every one of us. Are we asleep in the daytime? Are we asleep in the light? One of the stanzas, the second stanza says, oh, bless me, Lord. Oh, bless me, Lord. It's all I ever hear. No one aches, no one hurts, no one even sheds one tear. But he cries, Jesus Christ, he weeps, he bleeds, and he cares for your need. Oh, bless me, Lord. Oh, bless me, Lord. It's all Jesus ever hears from us. No one aches about the souls that are perishing. No one weeps as he weeps. No one cares, and from time to time, he brings men, women before us, expecting that we will be the instrument that will bring salvation to them. But we are busy. We are sleeping the light, and we let them go away back to the streets. God is going to hold me and you accountable one day. What do I have to say when it comes? Praise the Lord. As we were told by pastor a few weeks ago, especially those who join us in the Bible study, the Redeemed Christian Church of God has what we call a vision that was actually last year. So it's not even this year. Vision 2032 is the vision, name of the vision. And it started last year for 10 years. So from 2023 to 2032. We're going to be, this month, as we've been told, we're going to have studies on the Vision 32 in our Bible studies and that holds on Fridays. Those just joining us, Bible studies, as will be announced later, from 7:30 to 9 o'clock on Fridays online. And then Sundays, we meet here from 10. What is Vision 2032? Permit me to just give us some, rundown of what the vision is about. The Vision 2032 aims to grow the church, the Redeemed Christian Church of God, as a part of the overall body, the global body of Christendom, of Christ. There is a worldwide vision that is targeted at saying 2,000 years after Jesus arose and ascended to heaven, we want to win more souls for him, to celebrate 2,000 years of his ascension to heaven. And Redeemed Vision 2032 is just an element of that bigger global vision. In the Redeemed Christian Church of God, we want to grow the body membership from about less than 3 million, interestingly, very small, to about 40 million in 10 years' time, 9 years now. And you and I have a part to play. You and I have a part to play to bring about that explosive and expansive growth. It's not just a reality, but it's achievable because the harvest of souls is still there all around us. In fact, the way is the vision is to make it come closer home is just, talking about 400,000 units. 400,000 units of 100 persons each. When I was preparing this message, I said, thank God, even if I focus on my father's house alone, I'm sure we can be 100. My mother's children, grandchildren, so we're already 11 from my mother, including me, and then 30-something grandchildren, and if I bring in the spouses, we're already 10 towards 100. So what am I saying? The 400,000 units, we shouldn't be looking at only outside. It includes even my own immediate household. Joshua said in Joshua 24:15, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. So when we're talking of soul winning, we tend to think it's only outside. What about my immediate family? Are many members of your household, your mother, your father, if they are still alive, your children, your spouse, your uncles, your cousins, your nephews, your nieces, how many of them have given their life to Jesus Christ? I told us in the Bible study not too long ago, and please, with permission of pastor, I will say that what I said then. I went to a military secondary school, and there we had seniors that you treated them like officers. They were superior people. You dare not talk to a senior. Or the punishment they will punish you with is military kind of punishment. And we were all scared. But I went to the university shortly after secondary school. And then on this day, I was yet in my first year in the university. There was an announcement all over the uni that a leader of the court was going to give his life to Christ. And the school wanted it to be a public affair. Everybody, the VC, the faculty deans, everybody was going to come because the court had disturbed the school for too long. And so the day came, and this man, and I saw it was my senior in my secondary school. I think not, maybe 2 days or so after, I ran into Senior Gary. That's what I call himself, blessed memory now. He ran into me and said, ha, Okiemute, that's my first name. You're a bad boy. I said, senior, what did I do? Because he was still senior. Even in university, the fear of secondary school is still continuing. You're a bad boy. Senior, what did I do? He said, I knew you in the secondary school. You were SU. You were one of those believers. But you never told me about Jesus Christ. If I had died and gone to hell, I would tell God it's because of you. Fear gripped me. This happened 1986 or 85, but I've not forgotten till tomorrow because I'm conscious of it. What he said might have sounded stupid, but he was speaking the word of God according to Ezekiel. If God has ordained you to be the one that will bring the light to your home, to your family, to your neighborhood, to your office, and you refuse, God will hold you responsible. How many of your friends are believers? How many of your colleagues in the office that you have access to, have you ever told Jesus loves you? Is it possible they are just waiting for you to tell them one day? Oh, they won't listen. How many of your neighbors have you ever told Jesus loves you? How many? Or you've concluded God is not interested in them? The Bible tells me, and I remind us today, that there's rejoicing in heaven over one, not two, not three, not four, one soul that is saved. Over one, not two. And how beautiful are the feet of them that bring glad tidings. We're talking about harvest. We're talking about bringing souls to the kingdom of God. You know, the vision even simplifies it. Even you can talk of, you know, when I was in Nigeria, Lagos, we had one of our parishes that had a church on the street. So on Sundays, where these boys go play football, we had a church there. So we will send you, and you won't go to preach in that church today. Because the boys are there playing football, but when they say a pastor is coming, they stop. And church starts. We clap. The word is shared. That's a church. That's the kind of unit we're talking about. You can extrapolate that to even take it on, spread it. Bringing souls to the kingdom, we need wisdom. this is the time to apply godly wisdom. Let me not digress from the message. But this is what Vision 2032 is about. And God is looking on to you, to me, to all of us, to be the ones that will be instrument in his hands. Let's not, when Ken Green sang that song, the man was a gifted man. He was a lone singer, lone ranger, lone music man. He could play his keyboard, big keyboard, without even looking. He was speaking to believers like this, and the message just comes. And he turns the message, he reads out his message in songs. How can you be so knob? How can you be so dead? Jesus rose from the grave, but you cannot even get out of your bed. If Jesus could rise up from the grave, the Bible tells you, if that same spirit that's in Jesus that rose him up from the dead dwells in you, that same spirit is able to quicken your mortal bodies. That spirit of God can quicken you, wake you up. But where's the passion? No one aches. No one tears. No one cries. That's the message of Vision 2032. That's the message of Vision 2032. If I go to heaven and my wife is not there, and my sons are not there, or my children are not there, I could say, well, but is it possible it should be incomplete? Would there be pain in my heart? Do you know, I have, for a long time, wondered where my father is. My father died 38 years ago. I sometimes wonder where he is. Then I was tired to, when I'm reflecting, I said, I remember. I was always a Christian at the age of 9, but you know, you can't preach to your father. Now wisdom has taught me better things. I couldn't talk to him then, but my father will wake us up. You can't miss church because of the transformation that happened in my life when I became a Christian. I've shared it many times in BTS. I was so dull, I couldn't understand anything. And on the street, evangelism, I was given a tract, and that's where I got saved. The man said, if you give your life to Jesus, he can do anything for you. And I said, sir, what did you say? Because I had failed and repeated primary 4. Was like that was going to be the end of my school life. He said, God can do anything for you. I said, sir, did you say God can do anything for you? He said, yes. I said, okay, sir, can God give me a new brain? I spoke like a child. When I was a child, I did things like a child. But thank God for that childlike spirit. Can God give me a new brain? The man of God kept quiet. I said, I think so. I said, then I'm giving my life to Jesus. That was the beginning of my transformation. I repeated primary 4. I've said it too many times. I begin to sound like a broken record, but I'm happy because it's true. It's an evidence of the love of God. Amen. First time repeating primary 6 took 6. I brought my report card on from my positions were last, second to the last. My best was third to the last. Clap for me now. I was very good. From there, I came to 6th. When I got home, my mother said, is this your result? I said, yes. Your result? I said, how? I said, I can read now. I can write. How? I said, Jesus did it. Because I went to church that same week, and I never stopped. Sunday school, I quote scriptures a lot because that's what they taught me in Sunday school. My first memory verse that I quoted, I never forget. If any man is in Christ, he's a new creation. All things are past. And quoting scriptures is reading the whole chapter, not one or two or three verses. Reading the whole chapter. And then second time I went back, 10th, my mother said, what happened? I said, I think I overplayed. Third time, 6th. And my mother called me and I was promoted this time. She said, are you saying it's God that did? I said, yes, mommy, I have a new brain. My mother is alive. You see how you can ask her. He said, okay, can you tell this your God to give you the first position in primary 5? I said, there's nothing possible with my God. I would go to pastor's house, wash plates for him. I'd do anything. I was too happy because I could see transformation in my life. I said, I will tell God and I will take first. Come first time primary 5. I was at the top first. And my mother said, you buy anything I wanted for me. And what did she buy there? What did I have for clothes? And hey, now. But what I'm saying is that God is good. And there's somebody waiting to hear your message of love, of what God can do for you. Forget about the facade. Forget about, oh, I don't need anything. There's somebody waiting for you to comfort him with the love message of Christ. But you are sleeping in the light. May God wake you and I up today in Jesus' name.
Don't sleep in the light. Daytime is not the time for sleeping. Jesus rose from the grave. But you can't even get out of bed for Jesus. The Lord will help you and I in Jesus' name. I've not even started. I'm not going to look at pastor this morning, but wisdom is the principal thing, and my wife would always tell me, okay, amen, let's go on. Praise the Lord. John, let's read a few scriptures. Luke chapter 14. King James Version, please, technical for me. Luke chapter 14 from verse 15. I'll read very quickly because I have a few scriptures I want to read. Luke 14, 15. Are we beaming already? It says, and when one of them that sat at meat with him heard these things, he said unto him, blessed is he that shall eat bread in the kingdom of God. Then said he unto them, a certain man made a great supper and bid many, and sent his servant at supper time to say to them that were bidding, come, for all things are now ready. And they all with one consent began to make excuse. The first said unto him, I have bought a piece of ground, and I must needs go and see it. I pray thee, have me excused. And another said, I have bought 5 yokes of oxen, and I go to prove them. I pray thee, have me excused. And another said, I have just married a new wife, and therefore I cannot come. So that servant came and showed his lord these things. Then his master, the master of the house, being angry, said unto his servant, go out quickly into the streets, into the lanes of the city, and bring in hither the poor, the maimed, and the halt, and the blind. And the servant said, Lord, it is done as thou hast commanded, but yet there is still a lot of room. And the Lord said unto him, go out into the highways and hedges, and compel them to come, that my house may be filled. That my house may be filled. Amen. Matthew 9. I'll read from verse 35 or 36. Matthew 9, very quickly. Technical, I hope you're helping me. I'm not looking up. Matthew 9, 36, from chapter 9, verse 36. But when he saw the multitude, he was moved with compassion on them, because that they fainted and were scattered abroad as sheep having no shepherd. Then said he unto his disciples, the harvest truly is plenteous, but the laborers are few. He says, pray therefore the Lord of the harvest that he may send for laborers into his field. Lastly, let's read 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy, I'll read chapter 4 from verse 1 to 5. Very quickly, 2 Timothy chapter 4 from verse 1 to 5. I charge thee therefore before God, this Paul writing to his beloved son in the Lord Timothy, and the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall judge the quick and the dead at his appearing and his kingdom. Preach the word. Preach the word. Be instant in season. BTS, brethren, preach the word. Be instant in season. Oh, summer, there is a season. Winter is a season. Autumn, or what they call it, spring, they are all seasons. But the Bible says seasons are no excuses to preaching the word. Be instant in season. Be quick at each season. There are strategies to be applied for each season as far as ministering the word is concerned. And out of season, reprove, rebuke, exhort with all long-suffering and doctrine. For the time will come when they will not endure sound doctrine, but after their own lust shall they heap to themselves teachers having itching ears. From such turn away. The word, that chapter, verse 3, is where I wanted us to focus on. It is clear about God's plan for redemption of the soul of man. John 3:16 tells us, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten son, that whosoever will believe in him will not perish but have everlasting life. John 1:12, he said, he came unto his own, but his own received him not. But as many that received him, to them he gave power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. God is not willing that any man should perish. It's not God's desire for any man to perish. When he said to Adam and Eve that the day you eat it, you will surely die, And people will say, but everybody dies. The Bible was talking about the second death, and we had that series not long ago, even talking about eschatology, the end times. The death that you die and you is a perpetual evil. Let the fact that you know hell, have you ever tried to burn yourself? Hell burns with sulfur. Let the fact that you know somebody will be in constant pain that has no end propel you to want to share the word of God with them. I was talking about my father sometime when in my quiet times, moments, especially at his anniversary, I'm thinking, I don't know where he is now. But I know not long before he died, a driver, my father's driver that my father had dropped several years ago, came to our house. I was always having dreams of seeing my father dying, but I was naive. I was like a Samuel. I would say, go to Eli. I wasn't sure. I would be crying instead of doing what I should have done. Maybe, but I didn't have wisdom. This man came and we opened our house to him, and he said, sir, he came to preach to my dad. I just gave his life to Christ. I remember that encounter, and I know he led us all, he led my father and my mother to Christ. That day, Lucky was his name. Not long after, brethren, maybe I prayed to God to help me because he came. So sometimes I try to console myself that if my father made that prayer from his heart, that maybe he went to heaven. So I try to think of every member of my household now, and that's where it should start. God has a plan of redemption for mankind. Matthew 9, where we read, it's very clear that the harvest truly is ripe. But there are few laborers to bring in the harvest to the house. There are few laborers. And we think we have time. We always think we have time. John 9:4, please beam it. I must walk the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night cometh when no man can walk. My meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. Not to leave it undone. To finish his work while it is day. So that I will not make excuses while it is day. And you know, the harvest, like we know, when you have fruits on the trees, if you don't pluck them on time, what happens to them? They rot. And it becomes useless. So time is of essence. The king's work requires what? Haste. The king's work requires haste. The king's work requires haste. Urgency is required. Hebrews 9:27 talks about it is appointed unto every man who wants to die, and after that judgment comes. How many of your people have you ever told Jesus loves you? It was a tract that I was given. I hope you're not raising card already. No, it's not me. It was a tract. So sometimes even dropping cards, sometimes dropping tracts in holes, you're still doing the work. If you don't even know what to say, he already said, when you go, I will tell you, I will put it in your mouth what to say. Sometimes we are so scared, what have I got to say? That's why we shy away from evangelism. Even telling somebody Jesus loves you. The story of the young boy that told his father in a very rainy day, let's go out. The father tells him, oh, son, father was a pastor. It's raining. He said, daddy, does it mean there are no souls perishing and going to hell today? Father said, yeah, it's raining. He said, okay. And a young boy, maybe 6 or 5, I don't remember exactly now. And he said, daddy, can I go alone? Father looked at him, said, okay, go. And he gave him tracts. And this boy went around distributing the tracts. This is real story, true life. I'm not fabricating it. And this boy went around. And then after going around, it was cold, chilly, it was shaking because it was really cold. Remaining one tract, he said, should I go home? He said, no, I will not go home. I still must give this tract to someone. And God directed him to a home. He knocked on the door, and there was quiet. He knocked again. It was quiet. He felt like going, but it's like something held him back from leaving. He kept knocking. Meanwhile, inside the house was an old woman who had come to what you say, wit's end. As far as she was concerned, life was not worth living for anymore. Her only hope, her husband had died several years, and she was stuck in that house. No friend, nobody ever came to visit her. Nobody was interested. And so she had made up her mind that day, I'm going to end my life today. Today I'm going to end my life. And then she had gone up to, you call it Silla, what do you call the top house, to hang herself. She had already tied the rope. I was about putting her neck, and you know what they do? Then the knock came. This door that nobody ever knocks, what's going on? She said, okay, I will wait. Maybe it was a mistake because nobody was ever visiting her. And while she was waiting, oh God, let this person go now. I want to finish the work I'm about to do. And then the knock started continuously. She said, okay, let me go and see who this person is, dismiss him, and then I will come back to complete what I want to do. And she goes down and opens the door. It was a small boy. Mom, I'm sorry to bother you, but I just came to tell you Jesus loves you. And gave her the tract. And everybody, he went home. The next day, a Sunday in church, pastor had preached. And he said, does anybody have any testimony? And lo and behold, an old woman came to the front. She said, brethren, I've never been to this church before, but yesterday I had given up on life. I was going to kill myself, and this mysterious young boy comes, knocks on my door. I opened it, and I saw the most beautiful smile, an angelic smile, and he gave me a tract and said, Jesus loves me. That simple smile, and to hear that Jesus loves me, so warmed me. I thought no one in this world loved me. I ended up not killing myself. And today, I just came to thank God that I'm still alive. By this time, the father, of course, knew who he was. From the description, grabbed his boy. He was sitting beside him and just crying, asking God for mercy. You just don't know who and what that simple tract you give will do. The topic of my message is understanding the harvest. But even if I don't say anything more because of time, I believe we already understand the harvest because there is a manner that I have to follow. We need to understand the harvest. The harvest is about your household. It's about your friends. Think about it. Can you manage to see? I know women, their children are sick. And it's like they want to take over the sickness and say, God, let this sickness be on me so that my child will be free. That's even here on earth. Imagine you can see if God opens your eyes like God allowed Lazarus to see the rich man in Luke 16, looking down and seeing the rich man. If God opened your eyes, you are in heaven. You've made it. Thank God. Congratulations. But your loved one could be your spouse, could be your children, could be your mother, it could be your father, anybody. Let that help you to understand what this harvest is about. If God will allow you to now extrapolate and push this love to others, great, because it's all part of the harvest. Will you tell somebody today, this week, that Jesus loves you? Imagine even your enemies, you cannot stand it. You can't stand it. Somebody in pain, but the pain of hell cannot be fathomed by human mind. The pain of hell cannot be fathomed by human mind, no matter how you try to think of it. Let that compel you to want to share the love of God with somebody. Understanding the harvest. We need to understand the harvest. We need God to help us understand what this harvest is all about. It is appointed unto every man once to die. And after that, judgment. There's no two ways about it. Hebrews 2, reading quickly from verse 1. Hebrews chapter 2, from verse 1. It says, therefore, we ought to give the more earnest heed to the things which we have heard, lest at any time we should let them slip. These things you are hearing now, give heed to them. Don't let them, as you walk out of church, say, oh, they have spoken their own. My life continues as usual. My disinterest for evangelism continues as usual. For if the word spoken by angels was steadfast, when it was angels that spoke about the birth of Jesus Christ and all that, and every transgression and disobedience received a just recompense of reward, how shall we escape? Talking about understanding the harvest. How shall we escape if we neglect so great a salvation? Brethren, what Jesus Christ paid on the cross was not fun. For him to have prayed, he was God, but he could say, Father, if it is still possible, change your plan. Change this plan. Change it. Change it. I cannot imagine going through this shame, this pain. It was not easy on the cross. It was not easy. If you sometimes we think, okay, he died, fine. If you think it's easy, just put your hand on the wood and put nail and hit it. And you bleed to death. What shall it be? How can we escape if we neglect so great a salvation, which at the first began to be spoken of the Lord and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him? God also bearing witness, them witness, both with signs and with wonders. It's not an easy price. Say, Father, but let your will be done. On the cross, his father turned his eyes away from him. He turned his eyes away. He said, Father, why have thou forsaken me? It was not an easy price. The Bible says, looking unto Jesus, Hebrews 12. Maybe I read from verse 1. Seeing therefore we are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us do what? Let us lay aside every weight and every sin which does so easily beset us. Looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith, who for the what? The joy that was set before him, did what? Endured the cross. The cross was not fun. And that was for you and for me. Understanding the harvest. We already understand the harvest now. Maybe a last scripture, even along those lines. If we go to Revelations 21, Revelations chapter 21, we see those that will not be there. We see those that will not make it. Maybe I read verse 8. Is it verse 8? It says, but the fearful, the unbelieving, the abominable, the laborers, the murderers, womongers, sorcerers, adulterers, all liars. If I have someone close to me that is always lying, that is hell waiting. That should compel me to, you know, I said, this one is always lying. This one is always, that should compel me to preach the word of God to them. Praise the name of the Lord. For us to be effective, to understand the harvest, we already understand the harvest, but for us to have an effective ministry in evangelizing, there are certain things that we need even in our lives. For us to effectively prepare for the harvest, for us to effectively prepare for the harvest, there are things we must of necessity do. The man who wants to harvest, a farmer, and he goes to the farm not ready to harvest, doesn't carry any tools with him, he's not prepared to carry any harvest, he's not serious. That's what we can say. He's simply not serious. He must be prepared for the harvest. Similarly, for us to adequately, you know, ensure we make good use of the harvest and we harvest, even so, we ought also to be ready. So a few things and then I'll round up. What are some of those things that we need to ensure are in place to show that we are really prepared for the harvest, to have a bountiful harvest? Number one must be a desire in you and I. And that's all that I've been talking about. Jesus Christ already said in Mark chapter 15, verse 16, 16 verse 15 rather, he said, go ye into the world and preach the gospel. If you have a desire, say, if you love me, keep my commandment. This was a command he gave us to preach his word. But you need love to be able to preach the word of God. In John 15, 16, it says, you have not chosen me, but I have chosen you, and I've ordained you for one thing, to preach the word, to bear fruits that will remain and that will abide. Let that desire, the willingness be in you to be used of God. Let that desire be in you. If that passion is not there for souls, we read about Jesus being moved with compassion. He had compassion. Said, see souls that are perishing. That passion must be there. You are saved to save others. And others, we have taken time to explain who others are. You are saved to save others. Let's have that desire. Let's be willing. Let's show commitment to God that we are willing to be vessels in his vineyard. The second point is a lifestyle of holiness. You cannot preach to others when you yourself are not holy. In fact, your message, we used to sing a song those days, they are washing you, washing me, marking all I'm doing. They are hearing the things I'm saying. Let the Spirit of God dwell in me. I don't have time now. Just go on. They are watching me. My lifestyle is even, can preach more than my the things that I'm saying. I'm telling them do this, but I'm doing this different thing. I will not be effective. A lifestyle of holiness is required of every one of God. A lifestyle of holiness. We are called to be holy. You cannot talk about God who is holy and you are not living a holy life. Holiness is required of us. First Peter chapter 1 from verse 13. I'll read that very quickly. It says, wherefore, guide up the loins of your mind. Be sober and hope to the end for the grace that is to be brought unto you at the revelation of Jesus Christ. As obedient children, not fashioning yourself according to the former lust in your ignorance, but as he which has said to you is holy, so be you holy in all manner of conversation. God expects us to be holy. A compromising Christian cannot be effective in the harvest. A Christian that ignores his lifestyle cannot bring souls to the kingdom. Even if you succeed, well, souls will be saved, but you will not get any reward. You cannot preach about the holy God if you are living in iniquity or sin, because that will go ahead of you. Amen. The third point, so we've talked about number one, having a desire. Number two, living a holy lifestyle. What you say, what you do, whatever you do. Let the words of my mouth, the meditations of my heart be acceptable unto you, O God. The third point is prayers. Jesus Christ, even though he was God, did not start his ministry without waiting 40 days and 40 nights. He wasn't playing. He wasn't just doing sightseeing on the mountain. He was praying. Like I was saying to some of us who came yesterday for evangelism, I said, perhaps we should spend some more time praying. Because when you have done the praying, you just go out to just, the work is already mostly done on your knees in agreement. So we should pray. We should pray. Prayers play a vital role in preparing for the great harvest. And that's why perhaps Jesus, God even told the apostles, wait, tarry in the upper room. Wait until the promise of the Father is come upon you, which is the Holy Spirit. We should pray. It's not enough to say we want to go out. It's a great thing already, but please, the souls that we're talking about is a spiritual thing. It's not something that his physical mind can do. So we need to ask God for grace. We need to ask God for wisdom in the place of praying. We need to ask God for favor. So, talking about effective soul winning, being effective in the harvest, we should pray. We need to ask God to empower us. The early apostles kept on praying. They continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine, in praying, in breaking of bread, Acts 2:42. And the Lord added, in verse 46, several thousands such that should be saved because they were in one accord. So I'm talking of another one now, being in one accord and praying and breaking bread together, doing this together. Praise the name of the Lord. The fourth point here is the word. The word. The word of God should dwell richly in us. 2 Timothy 2:15 says what? Study to show yourselves approved unto God. A workman that needed not to be ashamed, but rightly dividing the word of truth. Yesterday, Rakubina and Sister Duni, and I think Sister Pepe, met one man who was too eager to show off, show intellect. He was a Muslim. He wanted to take them on a ride. He was ready. If you are not prepared, like Jesus was in Matthew chapter 4, devil knows the Bible. It is written, he told Jesus, he will give his angels charge over you. Is it in your Bible? Where is it? God bless you, my sister. And it's there. He quoted it. But, you know, the word was twisted. Jesus Christ replied him, it is also written, man shall not live by bread alone. Quoting Deuteronomy chapter 6. What time did Jesus have to? Fine, he's the word. We could say he's the word. So he knows what his word is. But he spent time also to study, I believe, because he was still a child at that time. Praise the Lord. It is written. I remember a long time ago in our local church back in Nigeria, we're talking of evangelism, and one man just said, yeah, I'm going to go out on evangelism. And the first person he met was also one of those who wants to, you know, take you on a ride. And he said, show me in your Bible where it is written synagogue. Hey, this man said, yeah, a pastor preached about synagogue the other day. I was not listening, no, synagogue, synagogue, synagogue. But God saw his heart. He said, he came back jumping after the evangelism. I said, okay. He opened his Bible and looked. And the first word his eyes caught was synagogue. When there is a willingness on your part, God will make the way easy for you. And he was so excited. He now started reading the synagogue and talking about, you know, Jesus going to the temple to pray. When there is a willingness on your part, God will bring the word. The help will come. The wisdom will come. Did he know that scripture before? You know, it was panting in his heart when the man said, oh yeah, show me in your Bible where the synagogue is. God helped him. Study the word. Study the word. 2 Timothy, if we may read it very quickly, and I think I'm rounding up now. Pastor, I've not spent too much time. It's almost done. Amen. Praise the Lord. 2 Timothy chapter 3 from verse 16. Bible says, all scripture is given, what? By inspiration of God. And it is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness. That the man of God may be what? Thoroughly furnished unto every good work. Have the scriptures, read the scriptures, and know it. And the last point here is, be filled with the Holy Spirit. We cannot oversay it. The same Acts chapter 1, the disciples were in a rush. They were ready to go. The same Peter that could deny Jesus even after spending time with Jesus for so long. What happened with this same Peter? This same Peter that the man said, is it not Peter that we know? This fisherman, talking with so much authority, asking the Sanhedrin, is it, consider for yourself, is it better for us to obey you and disobey God? Where did this boldness come? It is the Holy Spirit. And that was why Jesus told them, don't be in a hurry. Tarry ye in the upper room, and ye shall receive power. Acts 1:8. After that, the Holy Ghost is come upon you. You will receive power. The dynamo, you receive power. To be effective, to understand the harvest, and to be effective in the harvest, we need also the Holy Spirit to partner with us. Acts 10:38, how God anointed Jesus Christ of Nazareth with the Holy Ghost and with power. He went about doing good, healing all manner of diseases, even the oppressed. Why? God was with him. The Holy Ghost was with him when he was baptized in Acts chapter 3, Matthew chapter 3, and God was with him. No wonder he had an effective ministry. We need to ask God daily to help us. We need the infilling of the Holy Spirit. He's our teacher. He's the one that will guide us. He's the one that will tell us what to do. To be effective. To be effective. If I use this, my counter again, when I asked this teacher then and asked him, I said, sir, is it true what you said? He stumbled a bit. I said, the word of God says so, that God will do, can do anything for you. He doubted, but I took the first word he said, and I held on to that. And he prayed with me. The The Holy Spirit is the one that would help us. He would give us utterance. He said, we know not what to pray for. Romans 8:26. But the Holy Spirit does what? Helps our infirmities. We groan, it's too deep to be altered. That's what the Holy Spirit does. The Holy Spirit will give you the wisdom and the counsel. Let's rise up to our feet to pray, brethren. Effective harvest. Understanding the harvest. How many people in your household has been saved? I want us to ponder for a minute. That song says, "Must I go an empty-handed." A man who just came to know the Lord on his sick bed, and the doctor said he had but few days to live. He's cried to God, having understood the harvest at that late stage of his life. He cried to God, was like, "God, will I go empty-handed?" Was essentially asking God, "Even if I must die, can you give me a few days so that I can preach your word? Must I go an empty-handed, thou my dear Redeemer to meet? Even not one soul with wish to greet him, must I go an empty-handed?" You are not sick. You are not in the hospital. You have long life, because with long life, Psalm 91 says, he will satisfy you. Are you ready to ask God, "God, give me one soul, if it's even one soul today, even if it's one soul this month, if it's one soul this year, according to your several abilities"? Why don't you sincerely in your heart ask God? Is it only "bless me, Lord, bless me, Lord"? You know, it's all I ever hear from you. What? God is ready to bless you, but are you ready to do what is God's own business? Are we ready to do even what is God's own business? I thought we'd be praying by now. And I have 3 prayer points here that I will just read out for us to pray. Ask God to stir it in your heart, to be effective even in the place of harvest. That you will not be cajoled. It's not about begging you, "Please come." You want to. And it's not only when church organizes even the evangelism. On your own, you can make it a target that I would win. So I must talk to somebody today. I must talk to about somebody. As God brings them my way, I will not relent. Talk to the Lord. Lord, talk to him this morning. In Jesus' name. Say after me, "Father, I can't hear you." Say, "Father, let your blood cleanse me from all unrighteousness, so that I will enjoy your unhindered presence more than before." Go ahead, turn it to a prayer. "Lord, cleanse me from all unrighteousness, everything that has held me back in captivity. Cleanse me from it, O God, so that I will enjoy your unhindered access, your unhindered presence in my life continually." Talk to the Lord this morning. "Father, cleanse me. Everything that has held me back, O God, tonight, O God, I receive my healing, my deliverance in the mighty name of Jesus Christ." Thank you, Father, in Jesus' name. Amen. Say, "Father," I can't hear you. Say, "Father, I receive the Holy Spirit baptism afresh today. I need your boldness. I need your power for a great harvest in the name of Jesus." Go ahead and pray like the disciples prayed in Acts chapter 4. They asked God for the spirit of boldness, and the Bible says God answered them, and the place where they were kept was shaking. "Lord, fill me afresh with your Holy Spirit. Empower me, O God, that I will minister your word in and out of season. Lord, empower me. Lord, speak to me. Endow me, O God, with more of your grace in the name of Jesus Christ." Thank you, Father. In Jesus' name we pray. Lastly, say, "Father." Say, "Father, from today, because I'm now a fruit bearer, because I'm now a fruitful fruit bearer, I will seek opportunities to bring in the harvest wherever I go, starting in my home, starting in my family, my nuclear, my extended family, Lord, around me, my friends. Lord, I will bring in the harvest unto you." Thank you, Father. Go ahead and talk to the Lord. "Father, because I'm now a fruit bearer, because I'm now a good laborer in your vineyard,
From now on, oh God, I pray, Lord, as the opportunities come, as you bring the opportunities my way, Lord, I will bring souls to your kingdom. Thank you, Father. Blessed be your name. Blessed be your name. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Before I say the final prayer, all eyes closed. You are here this morning. You know you are yet to really give your life to Jesus. You cannot save others if you yourself have not been saved. I want us to, if you are such a one this morning in our midst, you want to give your life to Jesus, just raise your hands up. He sees you. The Bible says God is not mocked. He knows you, he knows me. You want to give your life to Jesus, just raise your hands up. That decision was made one day concerning every one of us here that are saved. I already shared my own with you. You want to give your life to Jesus and say, Lord, from now on, I want to be your child. Any hands raised up? God bless you. So there is none. So we all say we're all believers. Amen. Now, you know you are here, and there was a time in your life you could say you had great passion for souls, but somehow something happened, and you need to be reawakened from your sleep. Can you also raise your hands up? In fact, I would say, let us pray about that. If you were waiting souls before, you had a burden, a desire, you couldn't sleep. If souls are perishing, you couldn't. But now your love has waxed. Let every one of us pray. So it's not anybody raising your hands up, because it's laid in my spirit that we should ask God to quicken us again, to bring that burden for souls, the same compassion that Jesus